Hello and welcome to another edition of the inspirational program on Star Television Network called Live Your Dreams with me, Phebean Swill. This program tells you not to give up on your dreams. We inspire you to keep going, keep pushing. And so for that reason, we bring to you people who tell you their stories. Successful people who did not just wake up one morning and be successful. It's through hard work, dedication and perseverance. So by telling you their stories, there's something you could learn to inspire you and motivate you to keep living your dreams. In this edition, our guest is Professor Joe A.D Allie. He's going to tell us his story. Listen, pay attention, and be inspired to live your own dream.
Thank you.
Let's start by talking about your origin. What part of Sierra Leone are you from?
I was actually born in Mayamba town a few decades ago. Yes.
What's your tribe?
Oh, I'm in Mende.
Okay, on both sides?
Both sides, yes, mom and dad.
What? Yeah, I think different tribes exist from Mende or Mende.
Yeah, good question. Actually, my dad hailed from Serabu. In Bupechi, Udombo district. So that's the Sewama Mende, and my mother from Mayamba, Epa Mende.
Where did you grow up?
In Mayamba town. I grew up in Mayamba town, attended primary school there as well as secondary school.
Okay, which schools were those?
St. Columba's primary school, that's a Catholic primary school, and Mayamba Boys Secondary School, that's a UMC secondary school.
They produced someone great, I would say.
It's nice to hear that.
So, back in your school days, what type of student were you? I normally say there are three categories of them. Mm. You have the exceptionally intelligent, who really don't have to do much. They have it up there. They're very smart. You have the hardworking ones, who likely are conscious that I'm not that smart, so I have to work extra. I have to be serious to be what others are. And then you have the lazy ones, who either they're smart or not. They're just lazy. Yeah. They don't put much attention to schoolwork. So where would you bless?
The second category.
Which
not
is?
Exceptionally bright,
okay.
Not lazy, but just hardworking.
Okay, you know.
And it's quite an interesting question, because I remember I was in class 5 or so. At the end of the year, I got this result, and the class teacher said, he's a promising lad. And I was confused. I've never heard that word. So I came second. I found it difficult to take the result to my dad, because what had I promised this teacher for him to say I was a promising lad, not knowing that that was a compliment, you know?
So you're confused.
Yes, terribly confused.
Ah, you know? Then you are in class 5?
5, yes.
Ah, I see. Okay, let's take us through your days back in school. What are some of the things you remember as a schoolboy?
Quite a lot of things, you know. We are told to take our work very seriously, even to the extent of the way we handled our exercise or notebooks. You know, in those days, exercise books are supplied free to primary school children. But then it was your responsibility to ensure that you did not cut a leaf. Because when the exercise book was complete, you have finished working it, you brought it to the class teacher. If it was a 40-page exercise book, he counted. If it was correct, complete, then you'll be given a new one. So from that point onward, we, you know, that we have been, you know, taught to be responsible, not to misuse property as it were, whether it was public or private.
How were you able to make it through your education?
Well, basically through hard work. I went to school at a fairly young age, about 5. And then in those days, you know, when your parents took you to school, the teacher or head teacher would figure out whether you are mature enough to be in primary school. And the simplest way of doing it was for you to put your hands across your head, and if your fingers touched the other ear, then you are mature enough. If it didn't, they would say, take him back. Unfortunately, mine didn't touch. And so this teacher said, no, Pa Francis Ali, take this boy back, he's still small. But the dad insisted, and so I was admitted. I went through primary school the normal way. In those days, we had class SP1. We went through primary 1, 2, 3, up to class 7. Then you had SP1, senior primary 1. And it was at the senior primary 1 that pupils took the common entrance exam. That exam has changed its name quite a few times, from common entrance to selective entrance, and now to the National Primary School Exam, NPSE. So it was at SP1, senior primary 1, that you took the common entrance exam. But where you had some bright pupils from class 7, like the first 5 or 7 or 6, they will be asked to join the SP1 pupils to take the exam. And so I took the exam when I was in class 7 instead of the normal SP1 and went to Form 1.
Growing up, what were your aspirations in life? What did you always thought of becoming after education?
Well, to be very honest with you, I really didn't know, because I happen to have been the first child in the family from a polygamous family, all parents, stepmothers, all illiterate. So there was really no one to guide me, as it were. We just went to school. I remember sometime one of my relatives from the maternal side came to my dad one evening and said, Pa Francis, this boy here, he gets sense. Where he don't for fire now for make he go Bunubu Teachers College to become a teacher. You know, as far as that man was concerned, that was the best place for a bright student to go. So really, honestly, I didn't have anything in mind that after my O-levels, this was what I would do, because there was really no one, no role model, no one to advise, as it were. We just went through the life the normal way.
Your parents, were they literate or illiterate?
Illiterate.
Ah, I see. So there was no guide from them.
No guide. But one interesting thing, especially about my father, is that even though he was illiterate, he had an acute sense of position. Because at the end of the year, when I brought my result, this was in the primary school, because when I went to second school, I was either first or second throughout my 5 years. There was no problem, yes. But when I brought my result in the at the end of the year from the primary school, he would ask me, of course he knew I had passed. He would not just ask whether you passed, said in Mende, Nululemi Abuglo. What that meant was, how many people beat you?
For him that to, was his own yardstick.
Yes, to know my position. If I said 9, then he knew that I had come 10th. You know, and he was not just interested in saying I had passed. He wanted to know the position. That's one way, I mean, that's the most, definite way he would know, by asking how many people we are ahead of you. Yes.
I see. Yeah. So when you went to secondary school, where did you find yourself? In the art, science, commercial?
Again, because of lack of proper guidance, I found myself in the art stream, you know. But in those days, interestingly enough, whether you are an art student or a science student, we did almost all the subjects. Even as an art student, I had to do general science. That included biology, chemistry, and physics. Even at O level, yeah, we did general science. In addition to my normal arts.
So you ended up becoming the teacher that relative suggested you become.
Interestingly, yes. And again, that was not something that had been planned. When I completed my O-levels, I had an uncle in Kenema who was working at the social welfare as a messenger. So I went to stay with him for a while, you know, just, you know, and he had a friend who suggested to him that by then, you know, Kenema had this famous Forest Industries Corporation.
Okay.
Where they made all kinds of furniture, you know. And the man suggested that this boy could, if you like, we could enroll him as an apprentice machinist. You know, work. I would have become a very powerful carpenter by now. You know, he suggested that. And of course, without guidance, again, I said, oh, uncle, that's fine for me.
So for you back then, everything could pass?
Oh, yeah.
Because you didn't have
yes.
much?
Yes. This was in the middle of August. And he said, okay, he could start early September. Everything had been planned. The following week, I got a letter from the manager of the Catholic schools in Moyamba, because I'm a Catholic, saying I had, without applying for any job, I think my head teacher, my former head teacher in a primary school, A.J. Levy, who knew me even from secondary school days, knew I was good. I got this letter from the manager appointing me as an assistant teacher to the RC primary school in Rotifuk, without even applying.
So he did the application for you?
Yeah, I think the manager probably asked him to suggest names. And again, he suggested my name without any reference to me. So I got this letter, and those days, mail services were quite good, appointing me a primary school teacher. And I said, wait a minute, apprentice machinist, primary school teacher? I said, let me become a teacher. So that's how I went into the teaching field.
So it seems your life was built by other people, because you, by then, you were young and possibly naive, so you couldn't make the decisions on your own.
Yeah.
But now that you are a grown-up, assuming you had the opportunity to rewind time, to go back in time, what would you have preferred to be?
I don't think I have regretted being a teacher.
No, you, of course.
No, I don't, because an interesting thing happened to me when I had just been promoted to Form 4. This was in August 1966, waiting to enter the Form 4 come September. Coming from a polygamous home, my mother died unfortunately when I was in Form 1, you know, and life was quite difficult. After school, we'll go to the nearby forest, get some firewood, come sell, you know, did all kinds of things, even to the extent of selling kerosene per bottle after school in those days. And we went to a funeral ceremony at night. This was in August 1966, wakekeeping. I was in the veranda room. And by the time I came, everything had been stolen, including my books.
Wow.
Yeah, this was about a month before school reopened. And you could imagine my sadness and disappointment. There was very little choice. And in those days, we had a railway train running through Moyamba. So in the mornings, I would go to the railway station, carry loads for people, get something, you know, just to be ensured that I bought the necessary things before schools reopened. Because that was what I always did. I made sure that during the holidays, I collected some money through selling firewood and kerosene. And in those days, we had the CMS bookshop, what is now Sierra Leone Diocesan. They had a bookshop, a traveling van, that would visit these district headquarter towns at certain times of the year to sell books. I always made sure I had enough money so that when the van went to Moyamba, I could get my necessary books. So I began carrying jobs, I mean loads for people from the railway station. Fortunately, one afternoon there were CUSOs, Canadian University Service Overseas, teachers who had been posted to the school, carried their load to where they had been lodged. After that, the man asked me, this Canadian, he was called Martin Byers. His wife was called Joy Byers. You're a pupil? I said, yes, what school? Moyamba Boys Secondary School. Oh, I've come to teach here. I'm the English and literature teacher. And he said, would you like to stay with me?
Wow, you got lucky.
My whole life changed from that moment. This poor boy who was selling wood, who was now a star, because I was not only assured of a good place to study, a good place to live, good food, I was given a weekly allowance. Yes, I even got one of my friends to stay with me. So,
prior to that, how were your school fees paid? Was it by you doing the things you were doing?
Yes, and my father would step in, you know, but he would pay the fees. I really had no problem paying fees. He would pay the fees. But in terms of the ordinary things that a young boy would require, I provided those, you know. So stayed with these biases and everything was fine. He was a teacher in English and literature. And I was, these were the subjects I liked most, including history and geography. I became his best student. And so I began to develop some passion for teaching, interestingly, from that point onward. Although I had really not made up my mind by the time I took the O-levels. And then this opportunity came, you know, for me to become an assistant teacher. You know, and
okay, here's Professor Joe A.D Allie. He's our guest in this edition of Leave Your Dreams. He is well started as a teacher, now he is a professor. And when we come back, we shall be talking about his achievements in life and all of it all, and how he's going to inspire you. So be inspired with us, and we'll be right back after the break.
Previously on Leave Your Dreams.
In a corner on a Saturday night, everybody come try to be your friend. You wanna feel all right? Don't you feel so nice when the man MB they play? Listen where they all chant when the great man is singing. Listen where Elder sing say, oh yes, Attila man dangerous. Attila man dangerous, you know the musical vibes. Hear me now!
Whoa!
So, coming up next on Live Your Dreams.
I think it's a blessing and the wisdom, also the love I showed to them at the earthquake. 2008. I was the first foreigner. And you know those training for those army with the ropes like this? They call it cross country, something like that. I have like a medicine carried on my back, crossing with the army. If you miss, you fall down, you die. They don't even, they will find all your parties different side. Those are the place I went, and I was the only girl, African in bracket. And those people see the cry, the old country cry. They show it everywhere, CNN, China, everywhere. And Chinese said, this is the person that will never will kill ourselves for her, will die for her.
Welcome back from that break. You're still watching Leave Your Dreams on Star Television Network with me, Phebean Swill. Our guest in this edition is Professor Joe A.D. Allie. And yes, we come back to you, Professor. Professor, let's talk about your achievements in life. As your life as a teacher, what have been your achievements and successes?
Well, as I told you, after my O-levels, I was invited to teach, and I just developed some passion for it. So I went to Milton Magai Teachers College, where I did my higher teacher certificate, became a professional teacher. Taught for a couple of years in both primary and secondary school, came to Frobe College, did my first degree, honors history, did my master's. Immediately after my first degree, I was employed as a research teaching assistant at Frobe College in the history department. Well, first as a trainee librarian in the library department here, then later in the history department, and then later went for my PhD at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. That's where I did my PhD and a certificate in African studies. Came back to Frobe College, teaching, writing. Actually, I developed some interest in writing, which is really what a lot of people know me for.
Exactly, because you have written some books.
Yeah.
For primary, secondary, and general books.
Yes.
Tell us all the books you've written.
Quite a lot. My first book really was The Selective Entrance Test, English and Verbal Aptitude.
Okay.
While I was reading English history and physical education at Milton Magai College, we had these teachers, you know, who exposed us to writing skills. And so I developed some interest in writing. When I completed and went to teach first at the Islamic Secondary School in Kenema, after 2 years I decided I had some boys staying with me in the house. They were in the class 7, preparing for the then selective entrance. I noticed that we didn't really have books that would adequately prepare these pupils.
Yeah, like textbooks.
Yes. So I said, no, wait a minute. There's some gap in our education system here. You know what I did? I decided to come to the primary school to teach with my high teacher certificate. And I pleaded with the head teacher. This was in Boko, Catholic Model School. Pleaded with the head teacher to place me in class 7 so that I could, you know. While I was there, I started putting together some material for my pupils. Fortunately, we had this printing press very close to the secondary school, to the primary school, Bunumbu Press. And so I had friends there, and I started writing this, the first book, Selective Entrance Test, which a lot of people don't even know the title, they just call it Joe A.D. So I wrote that, and it became a bestseller. It's still a bestseller, yes. And came to Frobe College. When they employed me as a research teaching assistant, again, I was given some classes to take. I noticed that Sierra Leone history was not taught across the board. We had done Sierra Leone history in the honor school in history, but it was not taught to general students. I took up that challenge. I said, no, we must begin to teach Sierra Leone history across the board at the first degree level.
Is that how a new history of Sierra Leone
exactly came about? Immediately I completed, as I told you, I was first employed as a trainee librarian. And when I was working in the library at Frobe College, I was in the Sierra Leone collection. So I had access to all these materials. So while I was doing my master's, I was at the same time writing that book. And I finished the master's degree in history and the new history of Sierra Leone almost about the same time, which again, you know, a lot of secondary schools use, because I had access to the WAEC, West Africa Examinations Council syllabus in history, and prepared that, which again has become quite popular, I think, both at the secondary school and at the university level. Mm-hmm. So I wrote that, then I went to do my PhD, and immediately I came back, Macmillan Publishers, who were then in Freetown, contacted me to do some social studies books 1, 2, 3, for basic education certificate. You know, so I wrote those three. So I learned social studies, population education, 1, 2, 3, which again became quite popular textbooks. And when Macmillan was folding up and it became difficult for these books to be readily available in the market, I said, well, let me develop an abridged version of these books, you know, a pocket size like, which is a revision course. Then I wrote social studies for basic education certificate exam. Which has been all over the place. Then while here again, I have been dealing with quite a lot of students from across disciplines. I noticed that they had some problem even referencing materials, even, you know, how to study properly, how to write research papers. So again, I took up the challenge to prepare a guide for writing college papers for students in the social studies and humanities. So that was another book that came out. At the time of the 50th anniversary.
Yes, the
country's. Yes, a few years ago. I realized,
like 4 years back.
Yes, that a lot of people were interested in the history of this country, but they did not have, you know, some concise thing that could just give them a short history. So again, I took up the challenge to write an outline political history of Sierra Leone from 1961 to the present. Quite handy. I did that, you know. And more recently, I have been teaching quite a popular course at Frobe College, Sierra Leone since independence, to year 3 pupils. And this was how I developed my latest book, Sierra Leone Since Independence, History of a Post-Colonial State. That's a course that attracts between 300 and 350 students.
Wow.
Yes, yeah, so that's how my latest book came about, Sierra Leone Since Independence.
Through my primary school days, I, of course, read some of your books when I sat to NPSC, of course.
Yeah.
And then now, working, I've been using this, your book, A New History of Sierra Leone, because there's this program I do, it's called the Star Bulletin, it's an edutainment program.
Okay.
Some part of it has history.
Mm.
I did that book, beginning to the end, and people were asking, where are you getting your history material from? I said, it's A New History of Sierra Leone, done by Joe A.D. Allie.
And that's quite an old book. That book was published in 1990.
See how far it's gone. It's been very beneficial
since 1990.
The listeners of that program.
I've actually just revised it, and hopefully before the end of the year there will be a new edition.
People have been asking me how they could get access to those books.
Well, again, Macmillan used to publish that book, but Macmillan is no more in Sierra Leone and in Africa generally. But I've almost completed revising it. So before the end of the year, a new edition would come out. Because the one in 1990 went as far as the Momo regime, J.S. Momo, and several things have happened then.
Yeah.
Although the Sierra Leone since independence, this latest one, covers up to the elections of 2007. When Ernest Bai Koroma became president.
Ah, I see.
Yeah.
But then accessing these books, people who want to buy these books, they've been getting back to me to say it's very difficult to get access to the book.
Yeah. Well, for the NPSE and the social studies for Becker, I have an agent,
Okay, those are like textbooks.
Yes.
They become almost easily accessible.
The others, it's a bit difficult,
Yeah.
And what has happened over the years is that people have been pirating this book. They are all over the place.
Oh.
And most people think I'm a multimillionaire in this country.
Not
when I'm not.
Someone else is ripping off your...
Exactly. But we try to control that. Once I get these ones published, printed in China, hopefully before the end of the year, we'll make sure we control the market. And then when they come, we'll definitely advertise all over the country and we'll tell people where they could... buy these books.
You are a very successful man when it comes to the profession of teaching and lecturing. What would you say is the secret behind your successes?
It's not just teaching any subject. I have something that I normally tell my students, that if you want to do anything, either you do it well or you don't do it. That's the philosophy that has guided me throughout. And since I decided to become a teacher, there's no other way. I had to do it well. Otherwise, I had no business being in the teaching field. And that's really my message to anyone in whatever field you find yourself. Have a passion for the job. Do it well. And I'm sure you won't regret. You may not become a multimillionaire, but the satisfaction, particularly about teaching, the satisfaction you get, that you see quite a lot of your students become successful in life, that in itself, it's something to be proud of. Yeah, I contributed to making that person what he or she is today. I think it's the greatest satisfaction one can get from teaching, really.
There are some young people who think that the only way for them to be successful and make it in life is if they travel out of Sierra Leone and probably leave somewhere else. What would you say to these people?
I can understand why they think and behave that way, for a couple of reasons. The facilities for upward mobility are quite limited in the country. Even for a lot of young people who strive, who try to do well, the facilities are not readily available. And so they have very little choice but to go out. Again, there are others, of course, even where the limited facilities are available, they don't make much use of. And these are the people who would leave this country never to come back. They don't see anything good in Sierra Leone. But there's a lot of good in spite of all the difficulties. There's still a lot of good in this country. And I will encourage every young person, male or female, to make maximum use of the limited possibilities that are available. My life was not rosy, as I've just told you. It was really through hard work, what people call brute courage, that made me succeed. And I'm sure if a lot of our young people adopt that kind of thing, let them always look at the possibilities, not the obstacles. Let them always be optimistic. Sierra Leone may not be the best today, but at the same time, it's not the worst. And I am always hopeful that one day this country will go back to the golden years that people used to talk, those good old, good old days, But that's not going to come by chance. All of us individually and collectively have to work hard to achieve that goal. When we attained independence in 1961, one of the dreams of Sir Milton Maguire, the first prime minister of this country, was to make Sierra Leone a model state in West Africa. That dream is still alive. And if only all of us, including the leadership, political or whatever leadership, could go back to those ideals of independence, the ideals on which this country was founded in 1961, unity, freedom, and justice. We go back to those ideals and live by those ideals. I'm sure Sierra Leone will be a very wonderful place.
Professor, what would be your tips to young people, say, as steps to becoming successful in life? What are the key watchwords?
This world is a ladder. You have to take it step by step. You know? And my key words to them, one, success does not always come by chance. You know? People must work hard. No matter what the difficulties, if you want to succeed in life, don't always take the shortcut. There's no shortcut to success or progress. They have to work hard. They must realize that without hard work, most people will not succeed. There are very few people who, you know, who were born with a silver spoon in their mouth, to put it that way. But for the vast majority of us, that has not been the case. Our only option is to work hard. So my advice to young people is to always work hard. Look at the possibilities, not the obstacles. You will always succeed if you decide to work hard. And look at people who have succeeded in life. Read their life stories. How did they succeed? What did they do that I have not done? Or what did they do that I can also do to succeed? Not necessarily like them, because, you know, this life, we're all taking exams every day, but we have different questions to answer. You don't carbon copy. You can have a role model. Look at his or her life story and see what you can do to succeed. And there are several of them, you know, if young people can only look around, you know, and they will succeed. And the future of this country, the success of this country depends on you and me. We must strive to make it happen. And whatever little we achieve in this world, let us use it not just for our own personal benefits, but for the good of the country. So that will also be my other advice to young people, whatever field they find themselves in. Let them realize that they must pay back, help to develop this country, because no outsider can develop this country. Outsiders can only help us.
That's a very good lesson. But as we wrap up the program, Professor,
what are some of the important lessons you've learned in life that would serve as inspiration, motivation, and pushing people towards living their dreams?
A lot of lessons, you know, based on my personal life. I mean, that if I was not fully determined to work very hard and succeed because I didn't inherit any riches, you know, if I had not decided to work very hard, I could have been a failure. And again, sometimes it's good to take chances. For instance, I told you when I completed school, I mean, this, my uncle was advised for me to become an apprentice machinist. If I had not taken that bold step, that chance, say, let me go into teaching. Perhaps, okay, I may have become a very successful carpenter or builder or whatever. But then the contribution I would have made to society would have been very limited. Whereas when I went into teaching, I'm sure the contribution I've made over the years, you know, is quite substantial. Even if I were to pass away today, I'm sure my legacy would live on. You know, so again, it's good to take chances and have a dream and make sure that whatever happens, you must achieve that dream. There may be obstacles on the way. Turn those obstacles into possibilities. Then you are bound to succeed.
How many years have you taught for?
that's a very good question. That's a very good question. Really, it's a little over around 45 or something. Wow. Yes, I really spent all my adult life teaching, primary, secondary, university, about 45, roughly. And in the university alone, yeah, at Frobe College, when did I start teaching here? In 84. So by December last year, I had taught at Frobe College for from 84, 94, 204, 14, you know, about 30 years at the university.
Professor, thank you very much for taking your time to be our guest in this edition of Live Your Dreams and hosting us in your home.
Thank you, Phebean. It's my pleasure.
That's all we have time for in this edition of Live Your Dreams, the inspirational program on Star TV Network with me, Phebean Swill, that tells you no, it's not an option. Anything you want to be in life, you could be. It's just through hard work, dedication, motivation, and seriousness, you could be whatever you want to be. And that's why we bring to you role models, people who inspire you to live your dreams by telling you their story. I am Phebean Swill and I'm living my dream, so keep living your dream till next edition of Live Your Dreams.